Look at both of them, really. Hebrews 11 first before the song, but if you want to get ahead of the game and get Genesis chapter number 22 in your hand, that would be good too. And we know that help sometimes just be prepared. Hebrews chapter number 11. And we're going to read, let's read a little bit here. Let's start in verse number 8. One of my favorite verses in the Bible. God has spoke to me through the years in this verse about what he wanted me to do and how he wanted me to do it, and I love it. I'm not going to preach from verse 8. I'm going to get down to verse 19 and preach out of that, but let's just see what's going on. It's the great chapter on faith. And folks, listen to me. Without faith, you will not be able to make it in the mission that God has you on. What I mean by that is everybody in here is different. Everybody in here is not going to be a pastor, not called to be a pastor. Matter of fact, if we were all pastors, who would we pastor? Amen. God has different plan for everybody's life in this room. I do believe that God would want every single person to be faithful in the church of God, doing something in God's church. And so if you are not doing that, I would just tell you that you, maybe you're not growing yet, maybe you just got saved, all that, and you're not ready for that. But maybe you are, and you need to be living for the Lord, doing something for the Lord. And God wants us to do that. But we all have a life outside of this church also. And it is God's plan for us to, some of us that have children, to raise our families. Some of us that have jobs in the secular world to be a light to them. Some of us that have it's just us to find the path that God has for us and follow the Lord. And everybody's life is different. There are going to be different circumstances in everyone's life. Everybody's going to have something different. And it's going to be between you and the Lord if you make it. Of course, you have a pastor that will just tells you the truth and tries to love on you and tell you where you're at and what he thinks and what the Bible tells and different things like that. But it will really be up between you and the Lord. You will stand before God all by yourself with how you ran your race. Yeah. And so that being said, verse number 8, the Bible says, by faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should have to receive for an inheritance, obeyed. And he went out, not knowing whither he went. That just lets us know, guys, listen to me, you don't know everything. I don't know everything. People say, what are you going to do with this new church? I don't know. I know what my plan is right now, but my plan may not be the plan God has. But I just want to stay where I'm supposed to, do what I'm supposed to. And so Abraham went, it says, by faith he sojourned in a land of promise as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs of him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Now, what does that mean? It means he was looking for what God wanted his life to be. He wasn't looking for his own life, wasn't looking for a place to, you know, a lot of people with churches will, it hasn't happened here, and I thank God for that, but through the years, I've had one or two say, I'm moving. I said, where are you moving to? Years ago, one guy said, I'm moving to Florida. I said, what church are you going to? And I don't know. I said, well, man, that's definitely not God's plan for you to move to Florida. Right. And God ain't putting you and giving you a job anywhere and wanting you just to move and find your place when you get there. That ain't the way God moves. Right. God does it through what he has planned for your life first. And I'm not saying that a person can't get a job and be transferred to something, but if there ain't a church there, God says, do not go. Amen? And so, for he looked for a city which hath foundations, his builder and maker is God. Through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive a seed, and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. She knew God could do it. Therefore, I like it, therefore sprang there even of one, and him as good as dead, so many as the stars of the sky in multitude, and the sand which is by the seashore innumerable. Therefore what? Because he obeyed. Because he had faith, God used Abraham. And listen, we're all here today because of this man named Abraham's faith. Verse number 13, these all died in faith, not having received the promises, but seeing them afar off, were persuaded of them and embraced them and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on this earth. Look at verse number 17. By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac. And he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten Son, of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called, accounting that God was able to raise him up, even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure. I'll preach this message to you tonight. It's time to do some accounting. Time to do some accounting. Let's pray, and we'll have a song, and just come back and preach to you for about 30 minutes. We want the Lord to touch us tonight, and I believe that He will. And you say, well, where are you going with the message? Listen, I've been praying all day. God, which way, where do you want me to go with this message? So now I'm just counting on Him to take me where we're supposed to go. I know what I've wanted to say. I know what I've studied. I know what I've read. And man, I've spent a lot of time in this passage since the beginning of this year, really, because of Abraham's life. And we're going to look at it in a little bit. But I know that God has something for us tonight. I really do. And so let's ask God to touch us tonight. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Lord, without you, it would all be in vain, God. So we do pray that you would bless the preaching and teaching of your word. May you open up the hearts of everybody, including mine, Lord, that we might be able to be directed by you, and we might be able to hear your voice. We might be able to be led by you. And Lord, most of all, that we would be changed because of you. We'd be comforted. We'd be encouraged. The Word of God would be a light to our feet and a lamp unto our pathway. Lord, we would get something from you tonight that would help us to leave here with a full assurance of what you're doing in our life and that you are fully able to do it. Lord, please bless the preaching and teaching of your Word. We love you tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Thank you, Stan.
Through it all, God's been good. Sure, amen.
Faithful?
Yeah.
I used to have a little piece of paper around, but what happened to it, it would say, what if God was as faithful as you were?
I used to think about that a lot. I used to think, man, I'm glad he's a lot more faithful than I am. That would be a mess if he was like me. I thank God for how good he is. We've all, even on your worst day, you're having a pretty good one.
Yeah.
If you know the Lord. Amen. And you say, well, times get tough. Well, good. I mean, if the grass would never grow if it never rained. And I'm not saying that, you know, there's a lot of things people go through that I feel like, honestly, I could not handle. But I know that through God's grace, we can handle whatever he gives to us, and he could do that. Let's look at verse number 6 of Hebrews chapter number 11. Then we're going to look back at chapter number 22 of Genesis. And this is one of my favorite verses in the Bible. And I promise you, if we just followed this verse and we just realized the magnitude of what this verse is saying and we lived this, we'd be a lot better for it. I'm not saying we don't all live this. I hope that we all live it at some time in our life. But sometimes we don't live it. Bible says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Take your Bibles and turn to Genesis chapter number 22. Genesis 22, Matthew, Mark, Luke, Genesis. Genesis 22, I'm going to verse number 1. I'm going to keep telling that joke until people stop laughing at it. They always laugh, so it's good. Now, maybe you are doing it because you feel sorry for me. Like, let's laugh, so because he's getting old, he's repeating his jokes, and telling us everything over and over again. Genesis chapter number 22. We're talking about Abraham offering up his son Isaac. He said, what does that mean, he offered him up? Well, we're going to look at the story in Genesis chapter number 22. Abraham was one of the greatest Bible characters there is because he obeyed. God went to him. He was really a no good person. His family, his dad built idols that would be in the form of stars and moons. They were moon worshipers is what they were. They built idols, and they weren't looking for the Lord. And God came and got Abraham, just like he came and got you and me. He came to us first. We never went looking for God. He came looking for us. He said, well, someone invited me. Well, if you got saved, God spoke to your heart first. And God came and got you. And Abraham came on the scene in Genesis chapter number 22. And I believe he's only in the Bible for about 13 chapters. But he makes a great impact. And he's known through the New Testament as Father Abraham. He is the one that obeyed. He moved his family. He did something for the Lord. And God had been moving in Abraham's life. And we know that Abraham was 75 years old when God came to him. And he was living in a foreign country. And God said, Abraham, I want you to leave. And I want you to go where I want you to go. And I want to take you somewhere else. And I want you to leave your family, leave it all behind, and I want you to go and do this for me. And the Bible says Abraham obeyed when God told him to do that. And we'll look at some of that. And then he says that when you go, Abraham, I'm going to bless you big time. I'm going to make your seed as the stars of the heaven, as the sands of the sea. You're going to be blessed. All nations will be blessed because of you. And that all gets explained when grace comes and Jesus comes. And so now, because of Abraham's obedience, eventually the promised seed would come out of his line, which would be Jesus Christ, would come down through the line. And Jesus would come to the Gentiles. And now because of Abraham's obedience, all nations are blessed because of him. Because the gospel has gone into all nations, or a lot of nations. And we believe that the gospel is probably going to go into every nation before it's all said and done. And so God blessed him, and 75 years old, and he told his wife later on she was going to have a baby. And she laughed at it a little bit, but the Bible says in Hebrews 11 that she believed God. And so we know that she believed God because it says it right there. And so they ended up having this baby when she was 90 and he was 100. 75 years later, or 25 years later, they had a baby. This was going to be the one he talked about, that his name through this son would these people come out of? His families directly would come out of. Isaac would have Jacob. Jacob would have the 12 patriarchs, who would be Israel. And Israel would have many children, all these kids, and different things. And then we would get saved. And God says that God grafted us in with Israel. And we become part of God's people at this point. And so all nations are going to be blessed. Well, 25 years after, God gives him a child. But before that, some of you might remember that Sarah was worried about Abraham having a baby, and she couldn't give him a baby, so she sent her handmaid Hagar to go in and sleep with Abraham, and they ended up having a baby named Ishmael. Now, Ishmael is the direct line, where the line of everything, all the people that are, all the Muslim countries and different things that are going on, they're all from Ishmael's line. That's exactly right, what's happening. And God got rid of Ishmael and Hagar and said, no, this is not going to be the one that I'm going to bless like I'm going to bless Isaac. Now, I'm going to take care of them and I'm going to help them. And he never knew that, or probably didn't want all this stuff to happen. It's happening, but I'm going to bless Isaac. And so Isaac is now, they said he was a young lad. And so some people think he was about 14, 17 years old. He's not a little baby in this. And God goes to Abraham, and it's, we'd say it's probably 35 years after, or 40 years after he told Abraham and promised Abraham. Now everybody stay with me. After he promised Abraham everything, now God comes to Abraham, and look what it says in Genesis 22, verse number 1. And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham. Now that word there is the same word that we've used for tried Abraham. It is not a negative word. He's not trying to hold something over Abraham and get him to do something wrong. It means that he's going to try Abraham to see what he's made of. That God did tempt Abraham and said unto him, Abraham, and he said, behold, here I am. And he said, take now thy son, thine only son Isaac. Now, it's interesting that he says only son when he had another son named Ishmael. But this is the one that God wanted him to have. He got ahead of God and tried to do it himself. And when she couldn't have the baby, and they thought they were going to be able to have the baby. Take thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon the mountains which I will tell thee of. So take your son up to the Mount Moriah, and I want you to kill him. And then I want you to offer him as a burnt offering to me, like they would do with animals in those days. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of the young men with him and Isaac his son, and clave the wood for the burnt offering, and rose up and went into the place which God had told him. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said to his young men, abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again to you. Notice what he says there. We're coming back. We'll come back to you. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac his son. And he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and they went both of them together. And Isaac spake unto Abraham his father, said, my father. And he said, here am I, my son. And he said, behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? And Abraham said, my son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. And so they went both of them together. And I like that. God will take care of it, son. We're headed up the hill, and God's going to take care of it. And they came to the place which God had told them of. And Abraham built an altar there, laid the wood in order, and bound Isaac his son, and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched forth his hand and took the knife to slay his son. And the angel of the Lord called unto him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here am I. Now that angel of the Lord is the Lord, okay? And he said, lay not thine hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him, for now I know that thou fearest God, seeing thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me. And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him upon the burnt offering of the in the stead of his son, and he called the name of that place Jehovah Jireh, as it is said to this day, in the mount of the Lord it shall be seen. Jehovah Jireh means God will provide. In the mount of the Lord it shall be seen. Let's pray one more time, because I really want my thoughts to be right. And I really want to help you tonight. And we're not going wherever you think we're going. It's going to be just going to be different. But I know the Lord has given me this, and I feel like we can. I feel like the Lord can make it work for all of us. Heavenly Father, Lord, once again we come to you, God. I pray that you would help me tonight, Lord, to be exactly what you want me to be, the mouthpiece, and say exactly what you want me to say, Lord. We all have. You have a plan for every one of us, Lord, in our lives. And God, you're wanting us all to do something with our life. May we be found faithful when it's all said and done. No matter what our lot may be, may we just stick with you and trust you. In Jesus' name, amen. And so, I want you to understand, it's a very simple story. Some people say, well, this King James Bible, we just can't understand it. Well, I understood that just fine. We want you to take your son up there, your only son, and I want you to offer him upon the fire. I want you to slay him, and then I want you to offer him upon the fire. Now, I want you to understand, let's turn back to Hebrews chapter number 11. That's where we're going to stay now. Hebrews chapter number 11. He tells them to go up there and kill your only son, and you're going to burn him. Now, as Abraham's walking up there, we see that Abraham is walking with his child. He's not crying. The Bible doesn't say he's crying. He's not worried. The Bible doesn't say he's worried. He's not fretting. The Bible doesn't say he's fretting. He's walking with the little boy or the young lad, however old he was. And his son says, Dad, I see the wood. I see the fire, but where's the lamb? He says, Son, the Lord will provide himself a lamb for the offering. Don't worry. Hey, guys, we're going to head up the hill, but me and the lad will come back to you in just a little bit. And so it's important to understand that in this timeless story, to understand that Abraham always knew he was going to come back with God. Now, I don't know exactly everything in this, but the Bible does say that in chapter 11, verse number 19, accounting that God was able to raise him up even from the dead.
That's right.
So what that tells me is that Abraham was ready to kill his son.
Right.
Because Abraham knew, well, if I do what God tells me to do, I know God can raise him up. Now why would he think God's going to raise him up? Because God promised to deliver through Isaac.
Yeah.
And Abraham believed God because God gave him that baby in his old age. 100-year-old and 90-year-old women do not make babies. And God did that with them. And so Abraham had some serious faith. He'd been walking with God for 25 years. He had thought about the things that God had done. And the Bible says, accounting that God was able to raise him up even from the dead. And so I want to talk to you a little bit about that. I want you to understand what that word accounting means. It means this. It means to conclude or to number or to reason or to consider. It would be a good word. It's actually a good word the way it said it. Accounting. An accountant takes records and looks at how much money has come in and it understands the money and accounts the money and figures out what happened and understands everything that has happened in that business or whatever they're taking the money for. If we were to get a loan for our church, what they're going to say is, we want to see your accounting records. We want to see how much money you give. We want to see who gives, how many people give in the church. We want to know what your bills are. We want to know how much you spend here, how much you spend there, how much you have left over. That would be called accounting. And so what God was saying here in Hebrews chapter 11 is Abraham was saying, the Bible says, accounting that God was able to raise him up even from the dead. Abraham knew that supernaturally God had given him Isaac. Abraham knew that he did it in a very, very supernatural way. That it was unlike anything that had ever happened before. Abraham knew that God promised to bless him through Isaac, to give him children through Isaac, that would reach the whole world through Isaac and change the whole world, and all nations would be blessed. And so Abraham accounted that. He remembered that. He was not fretting about it. He was not worried about it. Did he want to kill his son? No. But he knew who he served. Now, to this day and age, we would never think of doing anything like this. And it's not the way it works today. But in this Bible verse, Abraham knew that God was going to be able to raise him up, that God was going to be able to take care of him. And it's put in the great faith chapter. Everybody stick with me now. It's put in the great faith chapter. And so it means that it took faith to believe that. And I wrote some things down about faith. Faith is to believe what we do not see. And the reward of this faith is to see what we do not believe, what we believe, to be able to see it. The world says, show me and I'll believe you. And Christ says, believe me and I'll show you. Only he who can see the invisible can do the impossible. A.B. Simpson said this, you will never learn faith in comfortable surroundings. Now, I'm trying to get somewhere, and I want to give you how Abraham figured it out, but then I want to apply this to us tonight and just make a simple application. The Bible says in Romans 4:3, Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. Abraham did some accounting in his life on how God had always helped him. And tonight, even if you just got saved, I can look back at my life when I did not even know God and see him the whole time really trying to take care of me anyways. And so Abraham did some accounting, and then the Bible says it was counted unto him for righteousness. And Abraham looked back. Abraham remembered that God gave him that boy supernaturally, so God's going to be able to raise him up. Abraham remembered in Genesis chapter number 12 and verse number 1 through 5 when God came to him. And listen to what he says. And the Lord said unto Abraham, get thee out of the country, from thy kindred, thy father's house, into a land that I will show thee. And I will make thee a great nation. I will bless thee, and thy name shall be great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse them that curse thee, and all families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abraham departed. You see, when God told Abraham to offer him 25 years later, Abraham said, wait a minute now. I remember how God came through with for me a long time ago. Amen. And how God told me to leave, and I did, and he always took care of me. Amen. No matter what's happened in my life, the road and the path that I follow that the Lord leads me on, he's always taking care of it. Now listen, that will help some of us in here. And for the ones that doesn't help, you better get on God's path.
Yeah, amen.
Because only the people in this room tonight that have ever followed God's path will understand how God is always taking care of them on the path. And then the rest of us will realize that God's been very merciful to me. And he's taking good care of me. And that's okay to account the mercy of God too. And Abraham remembered how God had taken him and called him out and got the job done. Abraham remembered in Genesis chapter number 11 when he went down to Egypt, or chapter 12 verse number 11, when he went down to Egypt looking for food. Some people say he should have never left. God would have took care of him. They said he went to Egypt looking for food, trying to take care of himself. And got himself into some trouble and made some big mistakes trying to give his wife away as his sister, and so he wouldn't get hurt, trying to give her away so they wouldn't kill him. He made some mistakes, and God still took care of him. That ought to make some of us in here understand that, man, God takes care of us even when we're misfits and we mess up. Abraham knew that. Abraham remembered God's protection. Abraham remembered how God had provided for him. Abraham remembered in Genesis 13 how God prospered him. Abraham, these kings down in Egypt was giving him all kinds of stuff, made him rich. Yeah. I mean, he had cattle, he had hired servants, he had so much stuff. God made him rich.
Yeah.
And Abraham said, now, he wants me to offer my son, but I know, man, he provided for me. He protected me. He prospered me. He remembered that stuff. In Genesis chapter number 14, Abraham remembers how God protected him from the enemy when he went to rescue Lot, when Lot got all messed up. And Abraham was protected from the enemy. Abraham remembered when those kings that Abraham protected Lot from and got all the people back from the war, the king wanted to give him some stuff, and Abraham said, "I don't want your stuff. God will take care of me." And then God comes to Abraham and says, "I will be your great reward." Abraham remembered that. He remembered all that. Abraham remembered how God chased away the enemies. Abraham remembered how God made a covenant with him. "Abraham, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to, just because you believed, I'm counting it as righteousness, and I am going to bless you so much." And folks, we have the same promise by God. Just because we believed and put our faith in the Lord, He's going to take care of us. And so, that being said, I just want to bring it down to you and me tonight. God's not going to come to us and tell us to kill our kid tonight. He's just not. We know that. Or nothing even close to that. But God does have a particular plan for every one of your lives. And His order of doing it. I've never forgotten something I saw written on the youth at the Calvary Boys Home in Eufaula, Oklahoma. It says, "I want to be used the way God intended to use me." And guys, ladies, men, God wants to use you a certain way. He said, "Well, I've already messed that up." Well, sure you have. Sure I have. But we don't have to continue to mess up.
Yeah.
You see, God has a certain direction for you, a certain direction for you, a certain direction for you, and God has a special plan for Him alone.
Yeah.
And He shouldn't want what I have. He should want what God has for Him. Now, just to let you know, some of the plans for our life ain't going to be all fun and games. There's going to be testings and trials and heartbreak. And what's God want us to do? He wants us just to trust Him. See, if Abraham has anything, he trusted the Lord with his life. And I'm not looking forward. I used to pray in Bible college, "God, I pray that you bring trials to me and Carol." And my wife heard that. She goes, "Bert, I don't want any trials." And she brought her mom and dad. My mom and dad worked their tails off to put us through Christian school and struggle and all that. And then, "I don't want to pray for that." And I said, "Honey, we're never going to be good Christians if God don't bring any trials into us, our lives." And I really don't want any trials with my kids and my health and all that. But God may do that. And God's looking for people that are going to have enough faith to trust Him and not give up and not give in and not stop, because God's plan for your life is different than my plan. And I could get bad news tomorrow. And what am I going to do? I'm going to have to trust the Lord, because that was His plan. Nothing gets by God that He doesn't know about. And I think about my preacher's wife, always in pain, constantly. I mean, constantly. Constantly back pains. Can't sleep in a bed. She sleeps in a recliner all the time. I mean, just constantly having to take pain medication. She knows that's God's lot for her life. And my brother, we'd much rather take that from his wife. I don't want to see my wife suffer. I'd rather take it. I don't see my kids suffer. I don't see anybody suffer. But listen to me. Abraham, God's not going to turn us into an Abraham where we got to kill our son. But God does have a plan that does not meet with what we want. Everybody understand what I'm saying to you now?
Yeah.
Your ways are not His ways.
Yeah.
And there's no way you got your life figured out. Matter of fact, a lot of us would be good to get out of our life and let God have our life. And stop trying to control everything in our life. Do we need control? We do need control. But we know we need so much control that God can't be the leader of our life. And God chooses people. And I used to think, you know, when God sent me here, I thought, man, I'm the most blessed person in the world because God trusted me to come place where nobody's going to come. What a blessing. God must have really thought something about me to think I could come here and make it when nobody thinks they could come here and make it. Well, the Pinchetti sons, all three of them preachers, they all came over to this building and said, no way, no way. They've been around God their whole life. I'm just saying, my lot's different than your lot. And heartaches are there, but listen, God didn't make a mistake with us.
Nope.
God didn't drop the ball anywhere. He hadn't fallen asleep. Nope. He's not scratching his head. He's not wondering
right.
what he did. He's
right.
not trying to figure anything out. And the thing is, I can't give you tons of little applications for everybody here because what I'm saying, the Holy Spirit's going to have to deal with you about on what it is God has planned for your life. And I'm not talking about just like super church serving and tithing. I'm talking about way past all
yeah.
that.
Amen.
The real thing that God has in your life. The bumps that God has in your life. The God didn't make a mistake with Abraham. He knew he could trust Abraham. And Abraham looked back and said, man, he's always done it here. He's always done it there. And you know what? Even if I kill him, God can raise him up. God can take care of that. And God saw that Abraham, and I'm not telling you that God's going to ask you to do something hard, and then when you finally give in to it, he's going to take it away, and you're going to be up. No, that's all I'm saying. God would like to do the impossible with everybody. But I am saying that God has a specific plan in your life, and if you're not careful, you'll have so much control in your own life, you won't see it and see the glory in it.
Yeah.
God puts us all through things for a specific reason, and it's to bring glory to him
yeah,
in some form or fashion. You understand that? God wants to do a miracle in our life, and God wants to have a place in our life. And Abraham, and if he wasn't careful there, he could have just not trusted the Lord and ran. And he would have missed. But he never felt like that because he always accounted that God was able. And so I hope that you have enough accounting in your past and your Christian life to look back and say, well, he did do it here, and he did do it here, and he can do it here. But I'm not even, I mean, honestly, I don't even know. Here's where I feel tonight. I don't really know what I'm talking about. I know that God says you preach to them and you tell them that there's going to be things in their life that they're going to have to trust the Lord with. And I'm not talking about ministry, soul winning, tithing, or giving to missions. I'm talking about real life
yeah.
obstacles that are going to come to you, and you're going to have to say, God, and you're going to have to wait for them. See, Abraham accounted that God was able because Abraham always prayed. He went to the place where he prayed. That's what it said, where he stood before the Lord in Genesis chapter number 19. That means he stood before the Lord in certain places. Genesis chapter 13, he built an altar. Genesis chapter 14, he went back to the altar. Abraham knew the Lord. And I promise you, I heard a man say this, and this is very good wisdom. If you don't learn to trust the Lord now, when you get older, you'll quit on God because your physical strength will give in. And honestly, David, I could get up here without God, without walking with God, and have enough physical strength to preach and to keep on soul winning, to keep on tithing, to keep on telling people about Jesus and do all that stuff in my own strength. But when I get old, my body starts falling apart. Then it's going to be determined how I live after that will be determined by the real strength that I really had and the real trust that I really had. And many of men and women have stopped serving the Lord because their strength was small and they were running on physical and gifts and different things that they could do it all without God. And then when they got older, they failed and they quit. And so it's so important. When that man told me that, I thought, man, I've got to really be careful, man. I don't want to. And I'm getting old quick. My body hurts all the time. And I'm only 46. only 46. When I said that, they thought, 46 to 26. Hey, listen, how is your strength tonight? Are you ready to do whatever God wants you to do, whether it be whatever it be? Here's the road I have for you. Here's what I put in your life. And we're just going to have to trust the Lord, man, and to keep on keeping on and not quit. I don't even know what I'm preaching tonight. I mean, I'm being honest with you. I hope that makes sense in some sense. But I know I'm preaching for something to somebody, to somewhere. And I've been praying. I've been at home going, I don't know why, Lord, why am I going to the pulpit with nothing? He said, you just go. And you just tell them, man, if they don't follow that road and understand the lot that God gave them was their individual lot. And it won't always be easy. And it seems like we look at why aren't they going? They go through nothing. They go through wicked always flourishing. Man, we're always getting beat up. And it's not true. Man, with the Lord, any major trial, if we have strength in God, really, we'll be able to handle it. But if our strength is small, the day of adversity, we will fail. And that's where we have to make sure. Do we have God? Are we really dependent upon Him? And are we really going to be okay with this? I mean, we're a young church. Brother Tony, Brother Wido. Brother Wido 1 week preached 3 funerals in our church in 1 week. 3 different funerals. I'm like, I don't look forward to that. But everybody, most people in our church are young people. And I may not have to start preaching a lot of funerals, but one day maybe you guys all will get old and hopefully I'll go before you, but I mean, it could happen. But that's God's plan for our life, is whatever He has for us is wherever we have to go. And we got to be careful not to get in a pity party and not to think, you know, why or anything like that. Abraham never did that. And I always think, man, I've never had any real problems. Something's got to give. I mean, something's going to have to happen. Eventually, all these people get these names and stuff happens to all these great people, good, godly people. Lord, something, you know, and I'm just waiting for something to happen. I don't want it, but I hope I trust the Lord when it does happen.
Yep.
And so, listen, tonight, I don't know where God takes you on that. I hope I didn't just confuse everybody. Nobody has any idea what just happened. That may be too. That'd be fine. But I know that He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him and believe that He is.
Yeah.
And Abraham accounted him able to raise him up even from the dead. And another verse later, he says, who was the heir? I mean, God said He was going to do it all through Abraham. Our time here is short. Life is but a handbreadth. Told those ladies at that nursing home, it's just but a handbreadth. Those ladies are 92, 93 years old, man. They're in their final chapters, probably. But they're all just looking to go. I mean, they're just like... And I'm thinking, man, I don't want to go. But I know that if the Lord's called that for me or for us, man, we just be happy to do what the Lord had for our life. He had a specific plan for you, and He gave it to you, and we ought to be thankful that He let us have it. He gave us a specific life. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Father, we love You. Lord, I thank You for the opportunity to preach tonight, God. I pray, Father, that You would just do some work here tonight. And